Good morning. Next Sunday, we will hold our Family Fun Festival at Camp Manawagon. Worship will begin at 10:30 a.m. I know that some of you are concerned with walking the challenging terrain of the campgrounds. Not to worry. For those needing help from their cars to the worship tent, shuttles will be provided. Remember to bring a picnic lunch for your family and a dessert that others can share. Seating and drinks will be provided. Join us in worship next Sunday at 10:30 a.m. at beautiful Camp Manawagon as we come together as a church family to worship our great God. Next Sunday, August 22nd, is the final day to sign up for the West Penn District Picnic at Del Grosso's Amusement Park on Sunday, September 5th. Meal tickets are $9 for adults, $8 for children. This includes a $5 discount ride pass. Christian artist David Dunn will be performing at 2 p.m., followed by the band Unspoken at 6. The women will gather at Camp Manawagon September 24th through the 26th. Brochures are available at the information desk, or you may register online.
Hey, Kevin, have you thought anything more about going to the men's retreat?
Yeah. I wasn't gonna go, you know. I just have a lot to do around the house, getting ready for winter. But lately I've been thinking that, you know how I'm always saying that I don't feel I get to know enough guys, that you walk through church on Sunday mornings, you say hi, you walk right by them, and that's it. And you just don't get to know guys more on a one-on-one basis and develop friendships. So yeah, I think I'm gonna go. I'm going.
Good. I think it'd be a good idea. I know at the women's retreat, we always get closer to one another, and that's where you build friendships and relationships.
Yeah.
Well, good. I'm glad you decided to go. And besides, that gives me a weekend by myself.
Hey, MGBC guys, 16 and older. Go online now and sign up for the men's retreat at Camp Manawagon. Encourage a friend, coworker, or neighbor to sign up as well. The men's retreat is a great opportunity to slow down from your busy routine and to grow spiritually through great worship and biblical teaching. The retreat is an ideal environment to encourage one another, strengthen relationships, and develop new friendships, and then spike on them in an endless game of nine square. Don't forget about the good food and the shooting range. See you there.
Good morning. Thank you for joining us here in the building or online. We do have a lot of really exciting things happening here in the life of the church, so make sure if you're not signed up for our update emails that you're getting those, and make sure you're getting signed up for the activities if you plan to attend. If you're in the building, we want to invite you to stand as we read our call to worship. Call to worship this morning comes from Psalm 48, verses 1 and 2. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised in the city of our God. His holy mountain, beautiful in elevation, is the joy of all the earth. Mount Zion, in the far north, the city of the great King. Let's worship together through singing.
I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thy all in all. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left the prison stain, he washed it white as snow. Jesus paid it all.
my soul to see, my lips shall still repeat. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left the crimson stain, he washed it white.
Oh, praise the one.
Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow.
Amen. You can be seated.
Well, we want to welcome you to the Martinsburg Grace Brethren Church. Thank you for being here today. Thank you for all of you who are joining us online and tuning in. Thank you for joining us. And we're just so glad to be here to be able to worship the Lord today.
Once again, we want you to know that next Sunday, we're going to be doing our Family Fun Festival. It's going to be at Camp Manawagon. Service is going to be at 10:30 a.m. Following that service, we have a baptism service. And if you are interested in getting baptized, today's the last day to sign up, so please go online for that. For some of you that might be considering that you don't want to do a lot of walking that day, as Pastor Brian mentioned in the video, and also for you just to hear this one more time, we will have a shuttle service once you arrive at camp that can help get you around that day. So don't let that be a reason why you don't attend next Sunday. Also, we have something going on Saturday, August 28th. If you are a male, if you are a man, please raise your hand. If you accustomedly eat throughout the day and a man, please keep your hand up. All right, so great. You qualify for the men's prayer breakfast on Saturday, August 28th at 8 a.m. That'll be a great time just getting to know the other men in our church, and it's a free meal, so why not show up?
And we also want to remind you that we go back to a single service on August the 29th. That will be at 10:15. We all have to compromise a little. The early service folks have to come later. And then for us who like to sleep in, we have to go a little bit earlier. You have to set the alarms a little earlier to come at 10:15. But we're excited about being all back together again. I know some of you here in the second service think, boy, you know, how's the church doing? Because there's definitely more empty spots this service than the first service. But the first service is fuller. So we're anxious to get back together as one family to be able to establish and continue to encourage those friendships together. So that will be on August the 29th at 10:15. And we'll have the ABF hour at 9 o'clock. Also, we want to be praying right now, especially for the people of Haiti. We understand that about 8:30 yesterday morning, there was a 7.0 magnitude earthquake in Haiti. It would be in the peninsula part of Haiti, as I call it, on the west side, which is not close to where our school and where the mountain church is. The Borel area is up in the mountains in the north. So they were not affected by the earthquake. But as you know, Haiti has been under a lot of unrest, a lot of problems. And that same area that got hit with the earthquake also had a hurricane several years ago. So they're just still recovering from that. And then the 11-year earthquake that hit Port-au-Prince before that. So the country is in dire need. And we want to pray for God to really work there. So let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for our friendships with those in Haiti, especially in the Borel area, and many of us have been there And we're thankful that the school was protected, the people were protected. But we know many of their countrymen are struggling today. We pray for that country that is in dire need and has a lot of long-term problems. But somehow we pray that your Holy Spirit will work there to move in people's hearts to come to Christ, and that some of these systemic problems can be solved eventually. But we know that this world is troubled. It's just a reminder that we really desperately need you. And that's why we're here today, to worship you. Many people here could be hurting, struggling. And I'm not sure all of what is going on in all of our lives. But we know that when we're desperate, when we're hurting, we can turn to you because you love us and care for us. And we can still be joyful and worship you because you are a good God. And so that's what we're going to do right now. Bless our service. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Please stand as we continue to sing.
I search the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures the faith. Never enough, and you came along and put me back together, and every desire is now satisfied here in the light. Oh, there's nothing
better than you. There's nothing.
nothing better than Jesus Christ, and he offers us a relationship with him. Jesus lived a perfect life. He never sinned, yet he took the punishment on the cross for our sins. We deserve punishment, but he took it instead. And on the third day, he rose again, giving us the hope of eternity with him. An eternal life with Jesus starts the moment we trust him to be our Savior. The moment we trust him, he's with us for the rest of eternity. He didn't stay dead. He's alive. He's working in our lives, working in our world. So let's sing about this hope we have in Jesus Christ as we sing the song Living Hope.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could
buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me.
Then came the morning.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. The buried body began to breathe. The silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory. Whoa. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Hallelujah.
Father God, thank you. Thank you for sending the roaring lion, your son. As he came to this earth and gave his life, went to the grave, but you raised him back to life. And that, Father, gives us hope. Because of that promise, we too will be raised with him for those that are in Jesus Christ. Thank you for the time to worship you this morning, Father. We thank you for your grace, for your mercy. In the next few moments, I just pray that our hearts will be open to your word, that your spirit will just lead us, will shape us, teach us, awaken our hearts and our minds to you. I give this prayer in the name of your son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Miss Jerry is over there for elementary school students, and Miss Erin is over here for preschool. Can you get me a drink? Thanks. I left it. Sarah is going to be setting up the monitor here. Today is her last Sunday for a while. She'll return, but Sarah has been helping, and she's been working part-time here at the church. She's going to GCBI, and she will be leaving us. And so we wanted to give her a moment of public recognition. And so wave hi, Sarah, to everybody, and we will applaud you. Thank you very much for your work here at MGBC and for your service here. Welcome to those of you that are here and to those online. It's great to see you all this morning. One of the greatest baseball players of all time is Babe Ruth. It was said that when Babe Ruth's bat struck the ball, that it would sound like a cannon going off. He had 714 home runs, and that remained unbroken until Hank Aaron, then eventually Barry Bonds, would break that record. The Babe was an idol to sports fans all throughout the United States. As he got older, though, his ability to hit the ball and to play baseball started to diminish, and the Yankees traded him. And it is said one of his last games he was playing, thanks, Brant, he was playing in Cincinnati. One of his last games, he had some difficulties. He had some errors in the field, and he struck out a couple times. In fact, the errors caused Cincinnati to have a five-run inning, and they eventually lost the game. But it was towards the end of his career, and as Babe is walking off of the field, the fans started to boo him and catcall and hiss and just boo his performance. He hung his head as he walked towards the dugout. A little boy in the front row jumps over the rail and goes out onto the field and grabs a hold of Babe's legs and just holds on. He picked him up, gave him a hug, set him down, and walked off the field hand in hand with the little boy. Loyalty is something that is desperately missing in our society today. Professional athletes play for a team for a long period of time, and then as money calls towards another location, they'll leave and drop the loyalty of the team that they have known for so long, and they will go to another organization. Employees bounce from job to job looking to achieve more money or better benefits. Fans that once admired the accomplishments of an athlete or entertainer suddenly disparage them and turn upon them because of their inability to perform as they once did. It's rare to find devotion in our society today. The same was true of Joseph's brothers. And Joseph, in our story today in Genesis 44, is going to be testing his brothers. He wants to ascertain the loyalty not only to their family, but to their father. There's a famine in the land, and the famine is intensifying. The brothers, Judah and his brothers, are back with Jacob, and they're running out of food. Now, you need to understand, this isn't a food shortage. This means that if they don't do something, they are going to die. They have to find food. The family will be wiped out. The children, the grandchildren, their father Jacob, all of them will die if they do not find food. So for a second time, they decide they need to go back to Egypt, to where that man was down there that would sell us food. But this time he said, don't come back unless you have your brother Benjamin with you. And so in Genesis 43, we read this, and Judah said to Israel, his father, send the boy Benjamin with me, and we will arise and go, that we may live and not die, both we and you and also our little ones. I will be a pledge of his safety. Excuse me. From my hand you shall require him. If I do not bring him back to you and set him before you, then let me bear the blame forever. If we had not delayed, we would now have returned twice. So Jacob permits Benjamin, his favored son, to travel back with Judah and the rest of his brothers to the man in Egypt to get food. They arrive in Egypt, and Benjamin and the family go before Joseph. Although they don't know it's their brother, they go before him, and they bow down once again. Joseph invites them to a banquet. Excuse me. Invites them to a banquet. The brothers are suspect of this invitation because they think that what's going to happen is once they all gather together, they're going to be arrested, that they're being led into a trap by the Egyptians. Verse 18 of the verse chapter 43 says this. And the men were afraid because they were brought to Joseph's house. And they said, it is because of the money. Let me pause there for a minute. The last time they came down, they bought food with the money. And when they went back, they found not only food in their bags, but also the money that they had bought. Somebody had put the money back into their sacks. And so they're thinking, this is what's going on. We're going to be arrested for this. It is because of the money which was replaced in our sacks the first time that we are brought in, so that he may assault us and fall upon us to make us servants and seize our donkeys. They think it's because of this money that was replaced that they're going to be brought in and arrested. So to get ahead of this, they pull the chief steward, Joseph's chief steward, they pull him aside. And here's what they do. They explain to him what has gone on. They explain to him that, listen, the last time we were here, somehow the money was back in our sacks. And I know you think we stole it, but we didn't. They want to get ahead of this possibility that they're going to arrest them. And here's what the chief steward said. He replied, peace to you. Do not be afraid. Your God and the God of your father has put treasure in your sacks for you. I received your money. He's letting them know, it's okay. I got your money. I put it back. Your God orchestrated this and put it back in your sacks. Then he brought them Simeon out to tell. Remember, Simeon had been in prison until they returned. Clearly, Joseph has been sharing the gospel of Jesus, or the one true God, Yahweh. He's been talking to his Egyptian friends, the guys that have been working. He's been sharing who the one true God is with them. They sit down to a meal. Is it a trap? To dine with a high-ranking official of honor? But the boys are skeptical. They think that they're going to be arrested as spies. But they notice something in the dinner as they come in and sit down at their table. They're seated from oldest to youngest. How did they know how to seat us in this order? Who would have that information? The other thing that they noticed is that Benjamin, the favored son of their father Jacob, received 5 times the food portions than anyone else. So they made these observations, and then following the meal, they received the grain that they purchased, and they were sent back on their way. But Joseph's favored silver cup has been taken and planted in one of the sacks of grain. It's a setup. You see, Joseph instructs his chief steward. He said, listen, when you pack their grain, take my silver cup and put it in the sack of Benjamin, the favored son. Make sure you put it in his sack. And then let them get down the road as they return home. Let them move on their way home. And then as they go, then overtake them and accuse them of stealing my favored silver cup, which is in Benjamin's sack. It goes as planned. The steward finds them and pulls them off to the side of the road and accuses them of stealing the cup. And here's how they respond. We did not do this. We did not take this cup. And if you go through the sacks of grain and you find this cup in there, whosoever sack it's in, they will die. And the rest of us will be your slaves. So they go through one by one, the oldest and then the next, all the way down to the favored youngest child, Benjamin, and they open his sack, and there's the silver cup that has been planted. The brothers tear their robes in their extreme anguish because now the favored son of their father Jacob is going to be executed as they promised. They're forced to return to the city, and they bow down once again before Joseph, and they offer up the son Benjamin in death. But here's what Joseph does. Notice what he does in verse 17 of chapter 44. But Joseph said, far be it from me to do such a thing. That is, far be it from me to execute Benjamin and keep you all as slaves. Only the man who was found to have the cup, Benjamin, will become my slave. The rest of you, go back to your father in peace. Joseph says, yes, Benjamin's sack, that was where we found the silver cup. He is going to stay as my slave. The rest of you, go back to your father in peace. Will the brothers be loyal to each other? Will they suddenly huddle up and try to contrive some sort of way to negotiate this, to get Benjamin free, to let him go back, the favored one of his father? Have the brothers changed? Will they take this opportunity to bolt? I mean, he gave them the out, right? Just leave Benjamin here. The rest of you can go. Will they bolt and leave out of there and leave him behind? Will they cut and run? Judah responds with one of the longest speeches in the book of Genesis. It starts in verse 18. The essence of his speech is this. We're not going to read the whole thing. It's this. He says, my father Jacob had two favored sons. One is no more, Joseph, who is actually standing in front of him, and Benjamin, the one whom they're arguing over. They cannot return home without Benjamin. He's the favored one. When they go back, Benjamin must go with them. In fact, Judah has assured his father Jacob that I will make sure that he returns to you. If necessary, I will stay as a slave to the leader of Egypt to allow Benjamin to return. The key word in Judah's speech is the word father. 16 verses, you see the word father 15 times. Keep that in the back of your mind as we continue here for the next couple of moments. As I said, we're not going to read the entire speech, but permit me to make a couple of observations. First of all, observation one with respect to Judah. Judah has undergone a great deal of change. Do you believe people really change? Do you believe people really change? I didn't share this with my mom, but my mom's brother, Sonny Merle Wyant, passed away, went to be with Jesus this week, my uncle. And so we were sitting on the back porch, and we were on the swing, and I was asking her about her brother, and I said, what was his early years like, or what was he like, you know, earlier after he came out of high school? And she said, well, let me put it this way. He was in the United States Navy. He was a sailor. And you can imagine all the connotations with that. And so my uncle, her brother, was pretty kind of rough around the edges early on in his life, as you can imagine. But then Jesus Christ got a hold of him, and the Holy Spirit started to make changes in his life. He became a deacon, an elder in his church, and treasurer of his church. And he would go into homes for the elderly, and he would sing to them and sing with them the hymns and spiritual songs. Sometimes we doubt whether people truly are changed, don't we? Are you skeptical when you see someone and you know their character from the past and suddenly their behavior, the actions, the words don't match the behavior that you once saw? Are you skeptical about that person? My second all-time favorite movie, not The Princess Bride, that's number one. The Sandlot. How many of you have seen The Sandlot? The Sandlot is my second favorite movie of all time. And one of my favorite characters is Squints Pompadora. Do you know Squints Pompadora? Okay, Squints Pompadora was afraid. He was unable to swim. Okay, and so all of the guys in the Sandlot knew that he couldn't swim, but one day they go to the swimming pool, and there goes Squints. He's walking towards the deep end of the pool. He's going down into the 10, 12-foot area down here, and suddenly Squints throws himself into the deep end of the pool, knowing that he can't swim, and all of his buddies start screaming, "He can't swim, he can't swim." Wendy Peppercorn, she's the lifeguard. She's on the lifeguard stand. She sees him in the water struggling. She dives in, swims across, grabs and rescues him, and pulls him out up onto the edge of the pool and pulls him out. And she starts to immediately give him mouth to mouth because he's not breathing. And all of his buddies are standing around. Oh, he's turning colors. He doesn't look good. And she's giving breath after breath after breath. Suddenly, on about the fourth or fifth breath, Squints reaches up, grabs his arms, wraps him around her head, and gives her the longest, wettest kiss that you've ever seen. Totally. To swim, to go into that water out of his character, but he did it for an ulterior motive, to get a kiss from Wendy Peppercorn. You see, sometimes we're skeptical about people. Sometimes we don't think they change, and rightly so, because they do things for ulterior motives. But Judah was radically changed by God, and it didn't happen overnight. Remember, Judah was there, and this whole thing started with him back when he sold his brother into slavery. He said, "What's going to happen when we see this Joseph coming towards us, the favored son?" Take a look at Genesis 37, verses 26, 27. Remember, Judah said to his brothers, "Here comes the dreamer. What will we gain if we kill our brother and cover up his blood? Come, let's sell him to the Ishmaelites and not lay our hands on him. After all, he is our brother, our own flesh and blood." His brothers agreed. Judah was the one responsible in leading the family to sell Joseph into slavery. Last week, Pastor Darrell pointed out that oftentimes our external circumstances can point out interior flaws or interior, internal wounds. In the case of Judah, those external circumstances not only demonstrated his wounds internally, but also began a process of change. His character and demeanor was changing. His sin of sleeping with his daughter-in-law, Tamar, assuming she was a temple prostitute. And when confronted by Tamar and confronted with the truth, he says, "She is more righteous than I." Clearly, something is going on in this man, and change is occurring. Benjamin has been found with Joseph's cup. Judah, the one, suddenly realizes that his sin is catching up with him. Take a look at verse 16 of the passage. He stands before Joseph and says, "What can we say to my Lord?" Judah replied, "What can we say? How can we prove our innocence? God has uncovered your servant's guilt. We are now my Lord's slaves, we ourselves and the one who was found to have the cup." Judah isn't referring to the guilt of the fact that the cup was in Benjamin's sack. That's not what he's talking about here. He's already proclaimed their innocence. What Judah is talking about here is, "God has uncovered in my heart my sinful actions against my brother Joseph long ago." That's what he's referring to, that this guilt has come forward. The revelation of our sin is often the starting point for change. Sometimes we have to be confronted face to face with the sin and the poor decisions of our lives before true change can really take place. Kind of like the prodigal son. Remember that story? Luke chapter 15. The prodigal son takes his dad's inheritance and runs off and spends it on all sorts of sinful behavior. He has nothing left. He's laying in a pigsty, eating the same food as the pigs. And what does he say? He's at rock bottom. Here's what the passage says. Then when he came to himself, he decided to return to the Father. When he realized his sin against the Father, that's what prompted the change and the decision of true spiritual transformation. See, external circumstances can reveal internal wounds, but oftentimes it's when we're at rock bottom that we really start to make spiritual changes and really start to have a change of heart and character. The second thing we see with Judah is he steps up to lead. Verse 18 of the passage. Then Judah went up to him and said, "Pardon your servant, my lord. Let me speak a word to my lord. Do not be angry with your servant, though you are equal to Pharaoh himself." Judah's not the oldest. Reuben is. Reuben's the one that's supposed to be taking the lead. Reuben's the one that's supposed to be looking out for the family. Reuben is the one that's supposed to be in charge. Remember, Reuben was the one when they were trying to negotiate with Jacob, "Hey, let Benjamin go with us to go down and get grain. Let him go, let him go." And Reuben steps up and says, "I'll take responsibility for him. If I don't bring him back to you, you can kill my two sons." Wow. It's easy sometimes to offer up other people for our own glorification, isn't it? It's easy to offer someone else up to make you look good. We do it quite frequently. We can throw someone else under the bus in order to make ourselves look good or to promote ourselves. We can crack a joke about someone else to make everybody look at us and laugh with us at their expense. But Judah doesn't do what Reuben does. Judah offers himself in place of Benjamin. In all that has occurred, Judah's wickedness, his lying to his father, the plan to sell his brother into slavery, and his sin with Tamar, God has been shaping Judah to lead. Finally, the third thing we see is that Judah offers himself as a sacrifice so that they can return to the father. Remember, Joseph has said, "Listen, I'll keep Benjamin. The rest of you can go back." And Judah says, "Let me stay in the place of Benjamin." Check it out, verse 32 of this passage. "For your servant became a pledge," this is Judah speaking to Joseph, "for the safety of the boy Benjamin to my father, saying, 'If I do not bring him back to you, then I shall bear the blame before my father all my life. Now therefore, please, let your servant remain instead of the boy as a servant to my lord, and let the boy go back with his brothers to the father. How can I go back to my father if the boy is not with me? I fear to see the evil that would find my father." If Joseph opts to keep Benjamin, it will kill the father. It's his favored child. Judah offers to remain as a slave so that his brothers can return to the father. But wait a minute, doesn't Jacob have 10 other sons, you say? Well, remember what was said in Genesis 42:38. But he, Jacob, said, "My son shall not go down with you." They're trying to get Benjamin to go, and Jacob's saying, "No, no, no." He said, "He shall not go down with you, for his brother is dead, and he is the only one left." Jacob doesn't even care or acknowledge the other brothers. He's so focused on the one that he lost and the one that he truly loves, Benjamin, that he's forgotten about the other 10. "If harm should happen to him on the journey that you are to make, you would bring down my gray hairs with sorrow to Sheol." Judah is moved by his father's love, so much so that he would put himself in Benjamin's place. Remember, Benjamin is the favored son. Judah is willing to sacrifice himself for another person that his father loves more than him. This is the first time in Scripture that we see human substitution illustrated. Judah is pointing us to Jesus Christ. Remember when I introduced this series a couple of weeks ago, there are two stories going on. There's a lower story. That's what's happening with the brothers. Judah and the brothers and Benjamin and Joseph. That's what's the lower story. What all's going on in Joseph's life, that's the lower story. But there's an upper story. That is, what is God accomplishing through the people that he's working with, Judah and his brothers? What is God accomplishing in his life? Through the victories and through the struggles, what is God achieving? See, they, like us, are players in this story. God is seeking to redeem his people through us. We are being shaped and molded and changed, used, if you will, for God's intention. Nothing in our lives happens accidentally. Nothing in our lives happens by chance. It's orchestrated by God for his purposes and for his outcome, for his redemption. Just like Judah was willing to give his life in exchange for Benjamin so that he and his brothers could return to the Father, Jesus later would do the same for you and I. Jesus would come, give his life, die on the cross in our place where we deserve to be because of our guilt, our shame. He would give himself for our sin, so that we then could return to the Father. Judah has risen to be the leader. He is the man of leadership, and he is the head of the tribe of Judah, the tribe of royalty. Consider what Jacob says on his deathbed with respect to his son, Judah. You can give me that slide. Thank you. Judah, your brothers will praise you. Your hand will be on the neck of your enemies. Your father's sons will bow down to you. You are a lion's cub, Judah. You return from the prey, my son. Like a lion, he crouches and lies down like a lioness. Who dares to rouse him? The scepter will not depart from Judah, nor the ruler's staff from between his feet, until he to whom it belongs shall come, and the obedience of the nations shall be his. You see, from Judah would become the great leaders of the nation of Israel, David, Solomon, and eventually our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Revelation 5:5 says this, John would write in his vision at the end times, and one of the elders said to me, "Weep no more. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has conquered." As Ryan and Sarah return to the stage to lead us in singing The Lion and the Lamb, I just want to draw your attention to the lyrics of this song. It says, "And our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains. And every chain will break as broken hearts declare his praise, for who can stop the Lord Almighty?" That line where he says, as broken hearts declare, sometimes what it takes is a realization of our sin. The sensing and feeling and the understanding, the conceptualization, and just the heartbreak of our sin that causes us to begin the process of change. Lasting and real meaningful change is available through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. But it begins with a realization of our sin.
Please stand and join us in singing. He
He's coming on the clouds. Kings and kingdoms will bow down. And every chain will break as broken hearts declare his praise. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb.
On today's message and the scripture from Genesis, I encourage you to take time and think about and discuss with your family, discuss with your small groups, whoever you're talking with. Think about and discuss how Judah's life points to Jesus, how Judah's actions in this story point to Jesus. And you'll find that question, if you need a reminder, as well as some others, on our follow-up website. So make sure you check that out. There's plenty of resources for you and your family. Thanks for coming. Have a great week.